Oh, you're ready?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Whenever you're ready.
All right. Everybody back that's coming, go over that one, the record, and proceed with, yep, tell me out.
Hi, there's a preparatory thing. And again, I'm not doing this to pick on anyone. It's, I have an obligation to my client. And I have to, again, raise an issue that I raised before, just for the record, just make sure I haven't waived anything about my client. I'm not trying to be difficult or disrespectful. But it seemed to me that during the course of Morgan Alexander's questioning the witness, it appeared to me, apologies, that she had already made the line about the text. On perhaps a variety of points. I would point the person on board to the own rules, which are during the evidence escaping one. And it states that procedural due process shall include a right to shall include an impartial hearing officer or board. It further says in section 3, from number 3, the basic concept of independent board requires that the inductees of which provide complete objectivity and independence make a decision that is an independent intellectual judgment based on solely upon the applicable laws, including rules, regulations, precedent, and the facts contained in the record. I think that last part is particularly significant because we have just now finished the record, and it appeared to me that Board Member Alexander has already made up her mind. I believe that in my mind, and on behalf of Mr. Baughman, it requires some due process for the person who made up her mind, the member of this board, since we're now entering very soon the decision-making phase. Now, again, renew my my objection or presence on the board. Again, I'm not trying to offend anyone. I just have an obligation to pay my clients to process interests. And I'll let you
know.
Well, what I would say here is that all of you participated throughout these proceedings from the beginning of the presentation to the end of the presentation. Including Ms. Alexander, her questionings and comments to the grievant gave the grievant full opportunity to respond or address any of her concerns. She certainly sat and listened to the last witness. There was only one more witness after the grievant. So you know, the request for recusal is typically a personal decision that is made of judges and arbitrators and personnel court hearing members, and so you know, really, that's Ms. Alexander's decision. If she feels like she cannot be fair, to render a fair decision based on the evidence and what she's heard, that's really her call to make. Otherwise, I think it's appropriate for this board to go forward as is. Unless Ms. Alexander thinks that she cannot be fair and she refuses herself, if she makes that decision, then I think the remainder of the board can go forward and render a decision. But understanding this process is, this board makes a determination and a recommendation to the county manager. I think that this board is fully capable of doing that in its totality right now.
Well, I'm going to state that your objection is so that it's the record. I'd like to go ahead and proceed. I haven't seen this like otherwise.
If you just said motion denied, I'll be happy. And that would complete my necessity of protecting my record.
Motion denied.
Right.
My legal opinion is Mr. Blitz has fully preserved this issue.
Thank you. I'm fishing for that.
Yes, sir.
Thank you again, all of you. I'm going to thank Tim Johnson. I want to thank the board. We appreciate the time and attention over the course of this appeal, which has covered the better part of 3 days. It's an honor to be before you personally. This is a volunteer board, and your volunteer service is important and invaluable to the county. What is before you today in Volusia County Exhibit 1? Final determination is four violations of the Volusia County Sheriff's Office standards directives that we believe the evidence shows that Deputy Baughman committed. We believe the evidence is overwhelmingly shows these violations. Before I get into each violation, I wanted to remind the board respectfully that the board's role is to consider all the evidence and decide whether the sheriff's determination is reasonably supported by the evidence that has before, got before you, and is not arbitrary, capricious, or discriminatory. Our position is that the sheriff's determination is supported by substantial evidence, which is when, upon your examination of the evidence in the entire record, including inferences you draw from such evidence, the evidence is such that a reasonable man or woman acting reasonably might have reached the same decision as the sheriff. We believe the sheriff's testimony alone is sufficiently substantial evidence, and his testimony remains uncontroverted. Volusia County proved each of the violations set forth in the sheriff's final determination, with the testimony of 3 witnesses and 20 exhibits we presented as evidence. With regard to the first offense identified as 26.233, inattention to duties, loafing, sleeping, which provides in part that employees shall be attentive to job duties and shall not neglect work by inattention while on duty. Both Sheriff Johnson and Sergeant Sawicki were clear in their testimony about how Deputy Baughman failed to show required attention to disparities that exist between Volusia County Exhibit 3, which is Deputy Baughman's incident report, wherein Deputy Baughman wrote that the victim signed a sworn statement advising she did not wish to pursue charges at this time. In Exhibit 4, the victim's sworn statement, wherein she wrote at the end, I wish to pursue charges. Deputy Baughman admitted to Sergeant Sawicki that I obviously didn't read the statement thoroughly. On January 13, 2016, before Sheriff Johnson, Deputy Baughman admitted that Sheriff, I was wrong for not reading the statement thoroughly. Now, his testimony today, Deputy Baughman, was a bit more revealing, and that he didn't qualify his mistakes as he had done previously. We believe the evidence is clear that this is more than not reading the statement thoroughly, as the sheriff explained to Deputy Baughman, and I'm quoting here, one of those two statements is a lie, end of quote. I'm going to address the second and third offenses in the final termination in reverse order, because the second offense listed is predicated upon repeated offenses of the same or similar as the third offenses. So we don't get to the second offense if we don't prove the third offense. That's the way they are recorded. With regard to the third offense identified as 26.2.41, negligence associated with the safety of persons or property, which provides employees shall be attentive to job duties and shall not violate official directives, orders, supervisory instructions, or knowingly refrain or cause another to refrain from the performance of lawful duties required for the safety of persons or property. Similar to the first offense, the uncontroverted testimony of Sheriff Johnson, Sergeant Sawicki, and even some of Deputy Baughman's testimony today, as well as Exhibits 3 and 4, also prove this violation. The consequences of this violation are exacerbated by prior similar offenses reflecting the repeated failure to maintain necessary skills, knowledge, and abilities after counseling and instruction. Sheriff Johnson and Sergeant Sawicki testified at length about the details of Deputy Baughman's disciplinary history. Their testimony and Volusia County Exhibits 1, 2, 7, and 8 through 20. These exhibits and the testimony show Deputy Baughman's repeated failure to maintain the required knowledge, skills, and abilities through repeated negligence and neglect of duties associated with the safety of persons or property, which substantiates the second offense identified as 26.2.133. That's the repeated failure to maintain necessary skills, knowledge, and abilities after counseling and instruction. Doing so shall result in increasing the severity of the discipline. Sheriff Johnson clearly expressed the concern and impact upon the sheriff's office and citizens when a deputy is negligent in domestic violence, sex offenses, and battery type cases. Sergeant Sawicki explained that within Exhibit 7 alone, there were 4 instances of Deputy Baughman's failure, the first occurring September 2nd, 2014, the second occurring October 13, 2014, the third occurring October 14, 2014, and yet the fourth occurring on October 24th, 2014. You've heard extensive testimony about Exhibit 7 today. When his management brought these performance lapses to Deputy Baughman's attention, Deputy Baughman became confrontational, resisting the counseling and instruction of the supervisors, and was relieved of duty for the remainder of the shift. This same evidence, the testimony of Sheriff Johnson, Sergeant Sawicki, numerous exhibits and evidence, as well as some of Deputy Baughman's admissions, also established Deputy Baughman's violation of the fourth directive, identified as 26.2.96, processing property and evidence. Property and evidence which have been received in connection with official duties will be processed in accordance with the provisions of the directives. Sheriff Johnson, Sergeant Miller, and Sergeant Sawicki testified at length about how Deputy Baughman should have gone about processing the available evidence made available to him on September 7, 2014, as well as collecting it. And you heard some of Deputy Baughman's own testimony today, which also supports that violation. The uncontroverted evidence shows that Deputy Baughman committed all of the violations he's charged with. Two of these violations are terminable offenses. With respect to the propriety of the sheriff's termination of Deputy Baughman, your own rules state that the board should not substitute its judgment and discretion for the judgment and discretion exercised by the sheriff if the sheriff has demonstrated that he is acting in good faith upon a fair investigation and has imposed a penalty that is not inconsistent with those imposed in similar cases. Only when a penalty is obviously excessive, unreasonable, capricious, or arbitrary should the board substitute its judgment for that of the sheriff. There's no evidence that the sheriff's termination of Deputy Baughman is excessive, unreasonable, capricious, or arbitrary. There's no evidence that the sheriff's termination of Deputy Baughman is not made in good faith. Similarly, there is no evidence that the internal affairs investigation conducted by Sergeant Sawicki was unfair or otherwise impartial to Deputy Baughman. Instead, the sheriff testified during direct exam and for hours upon cross-exam about the fairness of his decision-making process. He testified about other instances of deputies who had been terminated or resigned in lieu of termination based upon the same or similar violations of Deputy Baughman. He testified about the factors he considered before terminating Deputy Baughman. Because there are so many factors, each case is different. Depends on the facts and circumstances and requires careful consideration. Sheriff Johnson distinguished numerous instances of discipline based upon the circumstances and severity of the violations, impact upon the sheriff's office, disciplinary histories of the deputies involved, and other factors including performance evaluations, self-initiated training, and attempts to correct substandard performance. Sheriff Johnson likes Keith Baughman, but does not like his performance lapses, his repeated failure to use good judgment, and further finds his personal excuses and lack of accountability repugnant to the standards that he expects of Volusia County Sheriff's deputies. Deputy Baughman attempted to minimize his wrongdoing before both Sergeant Sawicki during his investigation and before Sheriff Johnson on January 13, 2016. Deputy Baughman characterized his wrongdoing as I was wrong for not reading the statement thoroughly. However, Deputy Baughman denied that his admitted wrongdoing was a violation of the BCSO directives. For the first time today, Deputy Keith Baughman admitted without qualification these offenses. I want to suggest that his testimony was contrived for you, for performance today, because he's testified inconsistently before the sheriff, before Sergeant Sawicki. He also testified today that he still disagrees with some of his prior written reprimands, that he never challenged them, he never filed anything contesting them. Moreover, Deputy Baughman's attempt to casually, causally, excuse me, causally related is lapses in performance and judgment. Two, personal issues in his private life are nothing more than rank after the fact excuses designed to get your sympathy. You heard testimony that many, if not all, deputies, including Sergeant McDonald, experience issues in their personal lives, but they are still required to perform within the DCSO standards and directives. Additionally, Deputy Baughman excuses are predicated upon the same bad choices and the exercise of bad judgment in his personal life that he exercises on a job, and for this reason are without merit. You don't warrant your sympathies. Also, you heard testimony that Deputy Baughman did not actually lose everything in bankruptcy. Instead, he discharged mortgage debt on an underwater home. That's a home that he and his former wife bought for $48,000, and after a series of refinancings ending in 2007, owed approximately $138,000. He also discharged credit card debt of approximately $3,000, along with medical bills. Deputy Baughman reaffirmed the debt on his truck. He really lost nothing except the extinguished and discharged debt in bankruptcy. You heard testimony about Deputy Baughman's marital infidelities leading to his divorce from his prior wife, Bridget Baughman. You heard testimony from Sheriff Johnson and Sergeant Sawicki about Deputy Baughman's misuse of the David system in September 2013. Characterize it however you want. He was viewing his female colleagues, some of whom he viewed multiple times. You can draw an inference there. That was September 2013. You heard testimony from Deputy Keith Offen that during the same month, September 2013, Deputy Baughman engaged in activity that resulted in Duke Energy threatening to file legal action if Deputy Baughman continued to contact Bridget Baughman's business contacts at Duke Energy. Deputy Baughman told you Sergeant McDonald advised Baughman to leave, move out. Deputy Baughman did at the end of September 2013. Again, Deputy Baughman's excuses and the sympathy he is asking you for are predicated upon the same bad choices and exercise of bad judgment in his private life that he exercised on the job, and for this reason are without merit and shouldn't serve to mitigate discrimination. We believe the evidence shows that Deputy Baughman's continued self-serving minimization, his unwillingness or inability to understand how his performance prior to today violates BCSO directives, his repeated failure to exercise good judgment, failure to acknowledge such failures, as well as the resistance and confrontational attitude he has shown toward his superiors along the way, serve to undermine his ability to learn from his performance mistakes and poor judgment, and hinder his ability to rehabilitate himself. The sheriff, Sergeant Sawicki, both testified about the sheriff's philosophy in believing in second chances for terminated deputies, or deputies who have resigned in lieu of termination following acknowledgement of their unacceptable performance or conduct, but only after time on the bench. By that, I mean sustained employment outside the Volusia County Sheriff's Office. Prior to today, Deputy Baughman refused to accept that his wrongdoing violated any of the BCSO directives that are performing in Exhibit 1. For these reasons, based upon the testimony you've heard and exhibits and evidence before you today, we ask that the board make findings of fact and conclusions upholding and sustaining Sheriff Ben Johnson's decision to terminate Deputy Keith Baughman from employment with the Volusia County Sheriff's Office. Thank you.
Give me a moment to gather my belongings. Thank you. quite a bit that we've been through over these 3 days, and like Mr. Moore, I do appreciate your time. Not many people would volunteer for this, and so we do appreciate your service, especially in this period of this. But I want to point something out that Mr. Moore mentioned. Now, looking at the personnel board rules, they're in evidence as KB1. There's some things I think that are important for us to understand and feel. The scope of the hearing, and I'm reading from Roman numeral 2 from the personnel board here. Hearings on appeals of disciplinary action are conducted with the purpose of determining, number one, where the employee committed the acts alleged to be the cause of taking disciplinary action is the basis of the appeal. Two, whether the circumstances actions and discipline the employee conform to the county merits and rules and regulations. Three, importantly, whether any evidence exists in defense, mitigation, or extenuation of the allegations. And fourthly, whether disciplinary action was appropriate under the facts and circumstances of the case. So I'm reading directly from the rules. Also, in the same rules, under Roman numeral 6, this is not patented in work point. There are two areas of proof in the deciding of disciplinary cases. The first involves proof of wrongdoing. The second, assuming that guilt of wrongdoing is established, concerns the question of whether the punishment assessed by the service group's actions should be upheld or modified. The service group in this case being for sure. That's again Roman numeral 7 under the subheading of findings of fact and conclusions in the personnel board. So I think that's an important construct that we need to consider. Now, one of the issues that Mr. Moore raised is whether or not the sheriff's actions in this case, his decision to terminate Equal, was consistent with simpler cases of alleged wrongdoing. And I think the part about this that perhaps blows me away most, and that's legal, moving on, is the treatment of a gentleman named Cobb. I believe his name is Brandon Cobb, if I'm not mistaken. Versus the treatment that Mr. Baughman received. I may be wrong on the first name. It is Brandon Cobb, correct. I want to direct your attention to KB12, if I can. And I think this is something we should really examine very thoroughly. Let me know your notes. Now, KB12, and this we're going to discuss KB19 along with it. The KB12 is an internal investigation report regarding the subject being Brandon Cobb. And this is a topic I discussed with Sheriff Johnson during my examination of him during the first hearing. Now, this document details the facts and circumstances surrounding a series of events involving Brandon Cobb. And the allegations that he left his assigned work area, violation of 26.2.24, that he also, 26.2.133, repeated failure to maintain necessary skills, knowledge, and abilities for counseling and instruction shall result in increasing severity of disciplinary actions, violation subject to dismissal. Well, that should sound familiar because that's when the allegations against my client are wrong. Repeated failure to demonstrate necessary skills. Also, it should also sound familiar, that Deputy Brandon Cobb was charged with inattention to duties, sleeping, or loading. Very similar to my client. In fact, exactly similar to my client. Also, in regards to that allegation, repeated failure to maintain necessary skills. Again, violation subject to dismissal. That's on page 2 of this document, Marcus, page 12. Also, exactly like Mr. Baughman, accused of negligence association with safety or persons. Now, what happened? We've heard about it on direct examination by the sheriff. Well, let's revisit it. Deputy Cobb received a call, and it's all there in black and white in KB12. He received a call from dispatch. Long story short, there's been a report from a citizen that somebody outside of her window has threatened to shoot someone. And Deputy Cobb
was assigned to go to that call. Now, what did he do? Did he go to the call? No. He went in the opposite direction. He went in the opposite direction to do what? He testified that he went to go get gas. Well, if you look on page 7 of this document, and you'll see, in the middle of that page, he's asked about the gas issue. Deputy Cobb, and this is the third full paragraph about halfway down. Additionally, Deputy Cobb confirmed that he heard Central advise the sergeant the details, male threatening to shoot someone up the call. Deputy Cobb was asked to recall a few levels before being at the time of receiving the call on Third Street. Deputy Cobb said, a hair below or right at half a tank. What else did he say? He went in the opposite direction because he's going to his parents' house to pick up his sunglasses and to take some Advil. Did Keith Baughman go in the opposite direction of the call? Did he delay at all? Well, he was delayed by a missing persons call, but he you heard his testimony. He went immediately after that call was cleared to meet with Jenny Duff. Not in the opposite direction. He didn't dilly that. He went directly to the call and spent an hour with the woman trying to get the information necessary to complete his report. Now, in regards to this, these findings, we're also saying everyone, I believe, I'm going to refer to the last page 8 and 9 of this KB-12. Every one of these violations were sustained against Deputy Cobb. Everyone, as they should be. Now, how was he disciplined? Well, let's look at KB-19. KB-19, I think, tells an important story of the disparity of the discipline. And why I'm so exercised about the fact that Deputy Baughman was terminated, taking his career, was taken away under circumstances that were, frankly, much less severe than Deputy Cobb's. Deputy Cobb, and you'll see this in KB-19, and it's on, you see the numbers on the bottom, you'll see Baughman and a series of numbers. If you look at 00067, that's going to be the final suspension that Deputy Cobb received for going in the opposite direction in return for a call, in regards to a call for service, with respect to a potentially violent crime, a statement by a resident, someone outside my door just threatened to shoot another. That's my book. That's something you go to expeditiously. You don't stop at 7-Eleven, you don't go to grandma's house. Now, so all the violations are suspended. If you look carefully at this, you will see on the bottom of page 2, which is marked as 00068, he was initially, Sheriff Johnson initially had determined that he was going to give Deputy Cobb a 40-hour suspension. Not a termination, a 40-hour suspension. Somehow, in the course of this encounter with the sheriff decided a 40-hour suspension for going the opposite direction in return for a call for service wanted a 12-hour suspension. 12 hours for going in the opposite direction in return for a call for service. Mr. Baughman gets called to go to a sexual assault report, goes there expeditiously. Doesn't stop anywhere in between. Deputy Baughman made a mistake. I'm not here to sugarcoat it, no question about it. You should have been more extended for the job. There's no other way to do it. You should have read the report, or rather the witness's statement, see that it didn't jive with his own understanding of what he told her, and offered a police report that was accurate and completely in the hearings because of what she said in the report. But at least he went. He went to the call. He made an error. We're not robots. We're not perfect. As you heard Sergeant McDonald said, even he, after 22 years of service, turns in reports from time to time to kick back on his lieutenants because there's an inaccuracy. There's something he didn't do right. These people are not, they're not machines. But at least, unlike Deputy Cobb, Deputy
Baughman did his bit for Gotham. He went to the call. He tried to undo the white flag. Did he do it perfectly? No, we'll get into that. But Deputy Cobb, the sheriff decides, despite these, I would say, fairly gross acts of honestly not following orders, is gross acts of negligence in terms of safety of persons. He gets a 12-hour suspension. Deputy Baughman, for going to the call, gets terminated because he made an error in not completely reading the victim's statement, making sure it guided what he understood the victim said. That's the essence of the inconsistency that I want to bring before you. And Mr. Moore pointed out that you should just uphold the sheriff's decision unless it's, you know, unless it's obviously inconsistent with other discipline. It is obviously inconsistent with other discipline. I mean, this literally jumps off a page and slaps you in the face. How inconsistent is the piece of the discipline work? Exactly the same allegations. Exactly. But in Mr. Cobb's case, far worse in terms of the facts. Now, we had a lot of discussion in the course of this case about mitigation. And, you probably remember the testimony from Sheriff Johnson about discussing the mitigation issue in terms of Keith Baughman. Well, there's something else I think that we should discuss and think about. You remember discussion about Michael Sawicki. Michael Sawicki is a deputy that was involved in a very loud and belligerent dispute with the patrol. And Deputy Sawicki was found to have committed a misdemeanor injurious to the department. And I asked the sheriff, what does that mean? Well, we found from the internal that he committed the battery on his corporal. Okay? Now, obviously, I don't have to tell you, that's a violation subject to dismissal. Hopefully you're not angry. He committed a misdemeanor injurious to the department, i.e. he battered it. And Sheriff Reed is a violation of the dismissal. Now, in that situation, what did the sheriff do? Did he terminate Sawicki? No. Now, I'll grant you, it's not the same facts. But what's interesting is the following. I asked, okay, because initially, and you can see it in the records, the initial thought was to terminate Michael Sawicki. But what the sheriff did is he considered mitigating circumstances. And do you know what the mitigating circumstance was? The mitigating circumstance was that the sheriff took into consideration Deputy Sawicki's role. And what he did, he called her, she was a major problem. And that may be. But flash by look, in this day and age, a problem girlfriend is not excuse domestic battery. Yet, Sheriff Johnson, he's entitled to make that call. He decided that problem girlfriend was enough to mitigate down from a termination to a hefty suspension to the decision with respect to Mr. Sawicki. If a problem girlfriend is enough to mitigate down a domestic battery from a termination suspension, should we not give a little mercy to Deputy Baughman? He didn't hurt anyone. He didn't get drunk and drive a patrol car to some unknown place like one of the deputies that we discussed. He behaved well. He carried himself well. He wasn't disrespectful to anyone. He didn't hurt a fly. What he did was he failed to notice the discrepancy between the victim's, Jane Doe's, written statement and what he put in his voice. Now, what mitigating circumstances existed at that point? Well, it wasn't a problem role one. It was he was going through a divorce. At the exact same time, these confluence of events were occurring. That's going to be a letter of reprimand Mr. Moore went on about. and this separate issue involving Jane Doe, he was going through the divorce. Was it his doing? Yes. He owns that. And believe me, he understands that. People make grievous errors in their lives. Things they wish they could take back. I've made mistakes I wish I could take back. I'm sure we all have. But he made an error. He was unfaithful. But the issue impacted him in a variety of ways. You heard him testify. He was unfaithful. Because of that, his marriage went to heck in a handbasket. And what did he feel other than just loss of his wife? He felt guilt. Guilt which will follow anybody. And, you know, and Sheriff Johnson even said in his testimony, he recognized that that sometimes your personal life bleeds into your professional life. And sometimes when you have personal problems in your life, you're sitting at your desk, you're sitting in your patrol car, and you may not just be as fully engaged as you should be. You may not have all the spin on the ball in the ordinary world. And that's a reflection of the human condition. Now, anybody who can, anybody who says they can completely divorce themselves in their personal lives and their professional one is either delusional or a liar. And Mr. Baughman felt these pressures. He felt them throughout this period. And they certainly contributed to the mistake he made. Now, it's my submission that even though Deputy Baughman may have been the cause of his own divorce, and the cascade effect was, of course, the bankruptcy, should he not be shown mercy? Should he not be shown some level of less severe punishment and termination for the offense of not noticing the discrepancy between one writing of the victim and his own recollection of the victim told him? Let's talk more about that. You know, you heard that about Baughman testify. that the victim told him on at least two occasions, I don't want to press charges. The other thing that really blows me away about this is that Deputy Baughman said that as I did. Nobody ever interviewed Jane Doe and asked her, did you tell that Deputy Baughman you didn't want to press charges? Nobody asked. Nobody asked her point blank, look, were you able to play the recording for Deputy Baughman? Because you saw her write a statement. At one point she says she vaguely was able to play it in another section of her same statement. She acknowledges that she was having difficulty playing it and was trying to get her mom to play it on her mom's Bluetooth, but it didn't work. There's an obvious glaring inconsistency between those two things, but no follow-up that asked her, hey, did you ever tell him that you didn't want to press charges? Were you actually able to play this recording for him? Because if here's the consistency of your testimony, nobody follows up for him. May we have him in his career on the line, and we have to do him the favor of asking questions of the witness that might serve to solidify his version of events? I feel like this investigation was not was a disservice to Deputy Baughman. But more than that, I feel that the service has been done in terms of the attention that's been paid to the litigation issue and the attention that's been paid to the issue of inconsistency between cases of discipline. Now, sorry about that. That's my voice got a couple octaves higher there. Now, let me also dig a little bit more in the deputy cop, because it gets worse. It gets worse. And I'm beating this horse because it deserves to be beat. If you look at Exhibit 19, and if you look at page 00075, this is a letter of reprimand that Deputy Cobb received. And I want you to know that this letter of reprimand was given 5 days prior to the incident that led to the final suspension on 00067. So, just to be clear, the discipline, the incident, the going in the opposite direction of the call regarding Cobb, occurred 5 days after he received this letter of reprimand up to 0075. If you look at 0068, you'll see that in his letter to Deputy Cobb, Sheriff Johnson wrote, Deputy Cobb, 5 days prior to this incident, you were served a letter of reprimand for negligence in which you failed to properly handle a call for service. Well, what was the call of service? Back to 00075, this letter of reprimand. In this letter of reprimand, this is all in evidence, and you can see the allegations here, submissions of reports and documents, negligence. It deals with Deputy Cobb, and you can see this under number two, specific date, behavior, and dates of behavior that support the charge. I'm reading now. Deputy Cobb, on 4-16-15, responded to 115 Florence Boulevard Berry after Jason Sila, disabled adult male, was egregiously battered by Jonathan Resnick, a 13-year-old juvenile in known criminal neighborhood. During the course of the call, when you fail to properly and thoroughly investigate the incident, and you fail to recognize the severity of the case, even though the victim is handicapped and unable to protect himself. While on scene, you influenced Mr. Zyla not to seek charges against the suspect, even after Mr. Zyla indicated he desired to do so. Deputy Cobb caught a disabled man out of cross-testing charges after being severely beaten by another person. Further, it indicates, in your attempt to prevent Mr. Zyla from pursuing charges, you alluded to an inappropriate relationship that didn't exist between Mr. Zyla and Jonathan Resnick. And just to add self-injury, apparently Deputy Cobb told witnesses that were nearby that Zyla is a drug addict and an alcoholic. 5 days before he gets this other final suspension for going in the opposite direction or return for call for service without shooting. I mean, it's eye-popping. It's eye-popping that this man, after receiving a letter of reprimand regarding very significant misconduct, gets a 12-day suspension for conduct that occurs 5 days later, and he goes in the opposite direction. I mean, think about the contrast. Think about it. Cobb goes in the direction. Goes to go gas up his car, which doesn't need gas, goes to pick up his sunglasses, might be broken. Doesn't go to a call about a shooting. Doesn't go at all. Doesn't show up. Somebody else has to. 5 days before that, he's given a letter of reprimand for, now, trying to convince a disabled man not to file a report. Telling him that, suggesting to him he better not, because we think there's an inappropriate relationship. Taking it, to me, is taking advantage of a disabled person. And you contrast that with Keith Baughman. 12-hour suspension versus termination. What did the man do? Fail to read the victim's statement thoroughly. I mean, again, there's a wow factor to this. And I think that wow factor is exactly the type of inconsistency in discipline that Mr. Moore touched on. If there's inconsistency in discipline, this board is called upon to correct it. How to correct it? Well, you could use a variety of things you could do. You could order that lesser discipline be given, that it could be reinstated, that he be given some form of suspension. There's a variety of things that you could do in this case to remedy this injustice that I've set forth before you. Now, let's take it a step further. We're not just dealing with Deputy Cobb and Keith Baughman. What about Sergeant Rico? I mean, you heard the sheriff. Deputy Baughman submits his report. It indicates the existence of the report. It does not indicate that the recording was collected. Not on the narrative, not on the property sheet. Go in the property sheet. This goes to Sergeant Rico. Sergeant Rico approves the report. Now, under direct examination of the sheriff, I want to turn your attention to the transcript if you're interested to follow along. If not, I can just summarize it. But it starts on page 113 of the transcript. Of course. Starts on page 113 now. I begin to ask Sheriff Johnson about the statement of Christopher Rigo. I ask a question on the bottom of page 113, starting at line 23. Now you see that the statement of Sergeant Christopher Rigo. Answer, yes, sir. Then on the top of page 114, he acknowledges that he was the patrol sergeant at the time that Keith Baughman took the report from Jane Doe. 114, page line 9. Question, an indicator before that sergeants are supposed to serve as a person to check several reports to make sure that they are complete and accurate, correct? Yes, sir. Question, okay, and I believe you called him a backstop. Yes, referring to Sergeant Rigo. Answer, you did. And you agree with that? Yes, sir. Question, and part of the role is to ensure that something in that report is either not accurate or something needs to be fleshed out more, or if evidence needs to be collected, and the deputy can do that, and the sergeant will send them on their way to correct those mistakes. Answer, yes, sir. Now, it goes on. Page 118. So he, line 17. So he, referring to Keith Baughman, completes the report. He or she completes the report on MDT and gives electronically transmitted to their supervisor. Answer, yes, sir. Page 119, line 20. Well, when Deputy Baughman hit send and Sergeant Rigo reviewed this report, he would have seen this help with sexual battery. Answer, yes. Top of page 21-2. And he would have seen that there was a recording of the incident. Answer, yes. Page 22, line 13. Do you think Sergeant Rigo failed, sir, in his obligation to serve as an adequate backstop or safety net for Deputy Baughman by not disapproving this report? And I say strike that. By approving this report? The answer on his own page, on line 20. Yes, I believe this instance he may have, especially knowing you have a deputy who seems not to follow through all his work. And I asked in page 23, page 123, line 22, so was Sergeant Rigo disciplined anyway for his approval of this report that should not have been approved to begin with? The best of my knowledge, no. You have Deputy Baughman lose his career because he made an incomplete report. But you heard Sheriff Johnson and you heard Sergeant McDonald both testify that one of the primary functions of a sergeant is to review the reports. Why? To serve as a backstop. Because Sergeant McDonald said, we're not perfect. They're not perfect. They make mistakes. So if there's something they notice that's incorrect, it could be grammatical. It could be a missing piece of evidence that's not been collected. Sergeant McDonald indicated he's observed circumstances like that, and he sent them back to be corrected. Sergeant Rigo had an opportunity to fix this. Sergeant Rigo saw that it was a sexual battery, saw there was a recording, saw there was no collection of the recording, but he still approved the report. Where did the discipline for Sergeant Rigo? He had an obligation, just like Deputy Baughman did. This speaks again to the inconsistency in discipline between Cobb and Brandon, or excuse me, Cobb and Baughman, to be sure, but with also Rigo and Baughman. He gets fired. Sergeant Rigo doesn't even have an IA commenced against him. Not a letter of reprimand, not a slap on the wrist, nothing. That's certainly something to me that smacks of inconsistency in discipline that this court should consider, excuse me, this personal board to consider deciding whether or not to modify, the discipline given to Deputy Baughman in this case. Now, let me see if I can skip ahead here. Now, let's talk for a bit about the alleged violations themselves. You know what? I said everything meander. Let me go ahead and meander some more. There were questions raised by at least one board member, and I don't recall the specifics at this point, but she pointed to the reprimands that Deputy Baughman received in the early years of his career. And she wondered aloud, how much is enough, in essence? Well, those written reprimands were in 07, 08, 09, 010. And there were several of them, the first to admit. But after that, and in light of that, what did the sheriff do with Deputy Baughman? He puts him as a field training officer. It's the cream of the crop. It is less than 7% of the total sworn population that you move, bestow upon the responsibility to train your deputies. Obviously, Sheriff Johnson had a great deal of faith in Deputy Baughman, even after those different reprimands that he received in his early years. Otherwise, he would not have made him a field training officer. You don't put incompetent people in an FTO role. You don't put boobs in FTO roles. You don't put marginal employees in FTO roles. You put your top guns. Because guns produce what? Better deputies. They sit in the patrol car right along with the trainees to ensure they're hitting on all cylinders, that they're riding their horse correctly, that they're handling officer safety issues correctly, that they're applying the law correctly. Why in God's name would you give him that responsibility if he felt he was a substandard employee after those left reprimands that he received early on? Now, let's talk for a second, my promise group meander being fulfilled.